Music Business Radio, brought to you by New Life Digital Media, your source for compact disc manufacturing, packaging, and fulfillment. Online at newlifedigitalmedia.com. And by Avenue Bank, locally owned and dedicated to serving Nashville's music industry. Find out more at thedifferenceisreal.com.
From Music City, USA, it's David Hooper and Music Business Radio.
Welcome to a special edition of Music Business Radio. This week our guest is Grammy Award nominated singer-songwriter Shawn Mullins. Shawn is best known for his 1998 hit single Lullaby, which hit number one. Shawn will talk about his 20 years in the music business, including his first indie release in 1989, his major label debut in 1998, and what it's like to go from a working musician playing small clubs to playing on national television almost overnight. Now let's listen in on this intimate conversation between David Hooper and Shawn Mullins on this special edition of Music Business Radio.
Shawn, welcome to Music Business Radio.
Oh man, thanks for having me.
Let's go back a while. How did you get started in the music business?
Well, my grandfather was a professional musician, and I'm from Atlanta, and he played in big bands from like the 20s until he died in the late 80s. Played upright bass and bass horns and bass guitar. You know, I grew up around music, you know, not necessarily folk music, but more big band music. And I'm a child of the 70s. You know, I listen to a lot of singer-songwriters. Chris Christopherson has always been kind of my biggest lyricist influence.
He comes up a lot.
Yeah, he came up. I heard on Jeff Steele's show that you guys did.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That was a funny story.
An amazing guy.
I don't know if Chris's wife, Lisa, would want to hear about that one.
Right.
But I thought that was great. Yeah, and Chris has become a good buddy of mine over the years, too. And he does have great advice. And a lot of it is just staying true to what you do, you know. But I got into it just like everybody else does. You know, I started playing in high school bands and garage bands and, you know, studied a little music in college. And I was a terrible student in college and high school and failed music theory. Over and over again.
Well, that's the key to success, though, isn't it?
I guess it is. It's bizarre, you know. It's sometimes I guess you end up, you know, making up for those things with other things, or sometimes the very thing that you fail at becomes the thing that you end up being good at, you know, composition or songwriting or whatever.
So back in high school, I know you had an interesting relationship with Amy Ray of the Indigo Girls.
That's when I first met her. I was in the ninth grade, and she was probably my first kind of tangible singer-songwriter influence, the first person I really met that did that, one person and an acoustic guitar kind of thing. And I was taking this elective called career education, you know, and it was like I was getting out of algebra or something, and I took that class, and, you know, any particular day they'd have like a doctor or a garbage man or an accountant. And on this particular day, Amy Ray came in. She's a singer-songwriter, and no one knew, you know, Indigo Girls weren't even called that yet. They were called Sailors and Ray. And it was pretty interesting. They had just formed, and she came in and played a couple of her own tunes. And it really blew not just me, but everyone in the class had their jaws dropped open. You know, I remember looking around at all these kids, and we were all just enamored with the passion and intensity and the truth that came out in her songs. I'll be honest with you, I wanted to be just like her. I was like, God, that's exactly what I want to do, you know. And I hung out after class, and I missed the next couple of classes, you know, just hanging out with her and, and picking her brain. And she ended up writing me this really long letter. You know, I got it a couple of weeks later. It was like several pages long. It was all about, you know, man, follow your dreams. Don't let anybody tell you that you can't do this.
So she really saw your passion, it sounds like.
She did, and she and Emily have both been really big supporters of me all through my career. They helped me get my start in Atlanta, you know, getting opening shows for them and bigger venues that I would ever play. So, yeah, they've been great friends over the years.
What's the biggest lesson that you've learned from her?
Not to try to follow a trend in music, to do what you do and do it well and study other songwriters that do that. And read a lot and keep up with what's going on in the world and all those things. But I think the main thing is to stay true to your art. That's what I learned from her and Chris and a lot of other successful people. It seems like that's kind of the one thing. It's like, you know, Chris had told Jeff to, you know, never do it for the money. And that's really true. The couple times that I've written things for knowing that there could be financial gain, it never worked out.
Mm-hmm.
I've always tried to stick to that and not do that, you know, and just really play from your heart. And that's the main thing, I guess.
Well, I know your first release was in 1989. It was a cassette, actually, which is so hard to believe now. It hasn't been that long ago, but just the music industry and the technology is changing so much. What did people think about like a self-released record back then? Certainly wasn't as common as it is now.
It was a pretty big deal. You know, I went to North Georgia College in Dahlonega, Georgia, which is in the mountains of North Georgia, and I was based out of Atlanta. I lived there. You know, I only printed up 500 copies of that, but they sold very quickly, you know, $5 a pop. And I would play around town. And I remember walking around campus and cars would drive by and they'd be playing the cassette.
Oh, wow.
And I remember thinking, wow, this could be something, you know. And I was just really starting to write songs that I was proud of, too. You know, I'd been writing since I was a kid, but around 19 or 20, I started writing more serious songs. And I think the first time I heard my song on the radio, it was a really big deal. I heard it on Album 88 in Atlanta, which is a college station there. It's a 100,000-watt station, though.
And, that's huge.
It is, for a college station especially. And I remember I felt like, well, maybe I'm doing something right here. And it took a long time for my dad, you know, to really get it. And I remember him saying, you know, son, don't kid yourself, you know. Who do you think you are, John Denver? He used to say that all the time. And I would be like, well, no, Dad, I don't think I'm John Denver. You know, he just didn't get it. And it wasn't until, you know.
And he was a musician, though.
No, not my father.
Your grandfather was.
Yeah, my grandfather was always supportive, and that was my mom's dad. But from the other side of the family, they were sharecroppers, and my dad, he was in the Army for a lot of his career and then went and worked for the railroad. It was definitely kind of a blue collar,
right?
Working class. Like, what are you doing? You know,
well, how did you break free of that? Because that's something I know our listeners can listen to. It's like, you know, hey, what about the 401k and what are you going to do for retirement?
Yeah.
You know, because musicians, you don't really have that. Not the same structure that a lot of guys do.
You know, I never worried about it. I still don't really. I just let the music take me where it does, and so far I make a pretty decent living. I'm not rich or anything, but I do okay, you know, and we work really hard doing it, but I'm lucky. I mean, every day I wake up and I think, God, I can't believe I'm getting to play music for a living, you know. It's mm-hmm. a really, and writing songs and getting to play the songs I wrote for people, you know, for several years, maybe 10 years, you know, I had to work a lot of covers into my set. And, you know, now when people yell out my songs at shows, I always say, hey, I'm just happy you're yelling out my songs and not Freebird, you know.
Wait, speaking about 10 years, it was about 10 years after that self-released cassette in 89 when you signed with Columbia. How did you get that Columbia deal?
Yeah, well, you know, there was a lady in Atlanta. She's still there. Her name's Leslie Fram. She's not in radio presently, but she worked in radio for many years around the country. And I had always sent 99X, which was the station she worked for. She was the program director at the time. This was 1998. And I'd always sent them a CD for their local show. And I had sent them a copy of Souls Core, which I'd put out in April of 98 on my own. And you know, I sent them a record. And one day I got a call, and it was Leslie. And she said, Shawn, this song Lullaby is a number one hit. And I said, yeah, right, Leslie. Sure it is, you know. I had no idea, you know, and she goes, no, it really is. She goes, listen, I tell you what, if you've got a box of CDs you can send me, I'll mail them to all my programmer friends around the country. I think you'll find that you'll be fighting off record deals in a few weeks. And she was right. It was the weirdest.
Amazing?
It was really cool. You know, you always hear stories of bidding wars and all that. And so many people, they don't have that going on. They're lucky enough to get a record deal. And I figured it would be that way for me, or that I would never get a record deal maybe. And I didn't really want one. By 1998, I'd put out a bunch of records on my own.
You guys were making a living?
I was doing okay. You know, I was putting records on credit cards. I mean, but still, I was getting by and playing little coffee houses all over. But she was right. Within a few weeks, almost every single major label had called our home phone. I remember Universal's president's assistant called and was like, you know, Mr. Morris is willing to open his checkbook, and you just named the price. And I was like, what? You know? And so I thought, maybe it's time to get a manager. You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
And I hired Russell Carter, who manages, you know, Matthew Sweet and the Jayhawks and Indigo Girls and many others. And he's a local guy. And I'd worked with him a little bit before with legal stuff. So he was a fantastic addition to my team.
Yeah, you know? He knew what you were worth.
I guess he did. And he hired a great attorney. And we went up to New York and we visited all those companies. And there became a bidding war. And next thing I knew, I had a great record deal with all kinds of little clauses in it. Like, in the publishing deal I signed, it's kind of an unusual thing, but I got a reversion in the publishing deal, which meant that when they dropped me, which of course they did, when I left Sony, the EMI dropped me. But 8 years after they dropped me, I get all my publishing back.
That's awesome.
Yeah, and I was pretty psyched about that because as a songwriter, really, that's how you make your living. You certainly don't make a lot of money touring clubs, even though we do a couple hundred dates a year. You don't make a lot of money doing that. You know, you were talking about 401k in retirement. Songwriting is what that is. I mean, that's...
It's an investment.
It's mailbox money, as they call it.
You're listening to a special edition of Music Business Radio with David Hooper and Shawn Mullins. When we come back, Shawn will tell us about getting the phone call that most musicians never get.
What do a banker and an artist have in common? Well, if you're talking about most bankers, probably not that much. But if you're talking about an Avenue Bank banker, well, that's totally different. Because we've got a group dedicated to serving those in the music and entertainment industry. From the songwriter to the label executive. From the promoter to the session player. From the established celebrity to the aspiring newcomer. Because if you're in the music industry here in Nashville, you deserve a bank that's also here in Nashville that's committed to helping you fulfill your dream, whatever it might be. After all, Nashville is a city where dreams do come true. I'm Van Tucker, Chief Creative Officer at Avenue Bank, and I'd love to talk to you about the Avenue Bank difference, and yes, the difference is real. Avenue Bank, member FDIC, and member of Nashville's music industry.
This is Alan Shacklock, record producer to Roger Daltrey, Andrew Lloyd Webber, Jeff Beck, Meatloaf, and Babe Ruth, and you're listening to Music Business Radio.
Welcome back to Music Business Radio with your host, David Hooper.
You're listening to a special edition of Music Business Radio with Shawn Mullins.
When those major labels were calling, what was that like, the very first one you got? Was it unbelievable? You didn't believe it was really them? Or what was that like?
Well, Kelly, my wife, she was my girlfriend at the time. She was the one fielding those calls because I was on tour. And I remember her calling me and saying, "You're not going to believe this, but Columbia Records just called. And there's this lady, Lee Danae, and she's a vice president of A&R up in New York, and she really wants to come down and see you and talk to you." You know, I'm thinking, why does she want to talk to me, you know? And it was an interesting time, and I had some great years on Columbia. You know, I don't have any regrets for being on that label. They were fantastic and got to work with a lot of really interesting musicians. And the opportunities, you have on a label like Columbia, especially when you're a priority, which I was for a couple of years. And so, yeah, they took that song all the way to number one, just like Leslie said, and it was a fun time.
Well, that had to be pretty amazing because a lot of people had heard you for the first time when that song hit number one. Now, what was that like? Because you'd been around for 10 years, and a lot of people, I guess, thought you were brand new.
I know. And, you know, I never really took offense to that. The funny thing about it was that I was 29 years old. Mm-hmm. You know, I wasn't a really young guy, already losing my hair, you know, and you know, just rode hard. And you know, I remember doing the American Music Awards and the Grammys and all these things. And the night I played the American Music Awards, there was a big tribute to Billy Joel that year for the Lifetime Achievement Award. And I got to do, you know, some of his songs.
Oh, cool. Cool. Which one did you do?
I did Allentown.
Oh, yeah.
And
it's a good blue collar song for you.
It really is. And he was a real pleasure to get to know. You know, Elton John and I ended up hanging a bunch and recording some stuff together. And he was another one of my heroes. So it was a crazy time. I remember at the American Music Awards, I was playing Lullaby solo, which is what I kind of normally do. When I left the stage of the Shrine out in LA, I was going backstage through the wings. It was all dark back there, and I bumped into this big black leather thing. I remember smelling leather and my nose kind of bumping into it, you know. And this massive thing turned around. It was Gene Simmons in full makeup.
Oh,
you
wow.
know, and he was like, "Hey, kid, that was really good," you know. And I was like, I felt like I'd been in a dream or something. And I remember waking up the next morning thinking, yeah, this is some kind of bizarre dreamscape I'm in, you know. It was a fun time.
Well, that sounds like a complete 180 from maybe a year earlier when you're playing these little bitty clubs. Did your old fans stick with you during that time, or were they thinking that you were selling out or that you changed?
Oh, no, no. I think my original fans and people that really dug my music got excited for me and wanted me to be successful. That's the feeling I got anyway. And I think they helped spread the love, you know, they really did. And, you know, it wasn't really until the first recording that I made for Columbia where they had me co-writing, and you know, I had a huge budget, and they had me working with all kinds of different people, and it really kind of took me off the path that I'd been on, and the sound changed. And
talk about the change in sound that you had. I mean, obviously, you're on a major label deal now. You're a priority, as you said. You're flying around the world, hanging out with Gene Simmons, Elton John. A lot of pressure for you to make that money back for this guys.
There was a lot of pressure, and it was they had put a lot of money into it. They'd paid me, you know, a huge advance, and I got another huge advance from the publishing company. And I think coming from that working class family, there was a certain work ethic that I already had, but now I felt really rewarded, and I wanted to do well for them. But I will say this, you know, I stuck to my guns and delivered a record that I thought was really great, and they really didn't accept it. That's kind of what ended up making things change. Is the original record I sent to them, they called me. I remember the president of the label was on the phone, Don Einar, and he was like, "Sean, I just don't think I could knock down the doors at radio with this." And I'm thinking, yeah, and, you know, but at the same time, you know, I thought I'd given them four or five singles, you know, and so they had me go co-write with people and have a co-producer come in. And most of that album, which was called Beneath the Velvet Sun, most of that record I really am still really proud of. It's a good singer-songwriter record. There's a couple of songs on there that ended up getting some airplay that I regret kind of the way we did it. You know, it was a little bit too slick and polished for my taste. And so after that, I just said, I'm never going to do that again. I'm not going to do it, you know. And
well, what happened to the material that you gave him that he didn't think he could do anything with? Just in the vault somewhere?
No, we still used all those songs. They just didn't hear a single. So I had to keep going back and writing, which is, you know, you hear that all the time where people have to go back and co-write and try to come up with some single.
How many songs did you write? I mean, I imagine you ended up with, what, 10 or 12?
Yeah, I think there were 20 songs. Usually there's about 18 to 20 that I'll go into a project with, and it usually pans out to 12 or 13 or something like that.
Well, let's talk about life after the major label deal.
Yeah.
How did it end?
Well, it was interesting. You know, I was, after Velvet Sun, I released, I delivered another record to him, which was untitled, and I was going to call it Cassiopeia. I loved that record. I loved those songs. And I delivered it to him, and I never even heard anything. No one ever called me. And I thought,
wow.
And this was 2001, just 2 years after the number one and a million records or whatever. And I got to thinking, you know, gosh. And about that same time, Johnny Mayer had come down. He had dropped out of Berkeley and moved to Atlanta. And he was a big fan of mine, which was weird. But, you know, he was nobody at that point, but he was a great guitar player. And he was hanging out at the little record company we ran. And my engineer demoed his first stuff and gave me the CD. And he said, "Hey, would you give this to Columbia?" And I was like, "Sure, man, I'd love to."
Oh.
And so I handed over the demo to Lee, who had signed me. You know, a year later, John Mayer was
You're brokering deals.
Yeah, that's
right.
Career
in A&R, maybe.
Yeah, I would have loved to have gotten a point deal on that.
You and me both.
Yeah.
Well, hey, let's talk about the DIY thing versus major labels. I guess there's pros and cons of both, right?
Yeah, you know, I still kind of feel DIY in a lot of ways, like I'm indie, you know, and especially now working on Vanguard Records, recording for those guys. It's a strong label, but it's an independent label. And they self-distribute and everything. What's cool about them is they don't get in the way of your creativity at all. Like, I've never had anybody from that label suggest one thing creatively about what I'm doing. You know, I used to have people, I'd have these meetings. I remember that in 2001, and you'd asked how it kind of all came to an end. That was really after the Thorns, when it kind of fizzled, because they thought the Thorns were going to go 6 platinum or something, and they ended up making a real slick record, in my opinion.
And the Thorns was a band with Matthew Sweet was in that band.
Yeah, and Pete Droege. Mm-hmm. And we had done these demos that were so cool, and we had recorded them on a front porch out in California in the middle of the night, and it was just this great, real feely stuff. You know, we went into the studio, and I started to get in a bad taste in my mouth about the whole thing, because the process was very different. They were taking Jim Keltner's drum parts and locking them to a grid. They were auto-tuning all our vocals.
Yeah,
they were doing all this stuff that is just not musical, you know? That's when I started really feeling like, you know, I just don't know if Columbia or if the major label system's right for me anymore. And I asked to be released, actually. That's how kind of it ended. They obliged. They were in the middle of trying to merge with BMG, and people were losing their jobs. In fact, the lady that signed me and John Mayer lost her job just a couple of years ago. It was amazing to me, you know, how much business she brought them. But I think now that I've moved on to Vanguard, it's a great kind of happy median from being completely doing it on your own and then having a major label do it all for you. Now it's, you know, we've got good street teams. They really work the grassroots angles of things. It's just a great team of folks, and they're all music people. And I remember one time I was sitting in a meeting with Columbia, and a marketing person was suggesting to me that I should write a bridge to this one song. It was like someone that puts posters up in the stores, you know what
right,
I mean? She was
right.
like, I really think this song needs a bridge. And I said, well, you know what? Why don't we, you and I just sit down and write the song together? And she says, I'm not a songwriter. I said, bingo.
Well, that took some guts.
I know. I could see the end was near, though, at that point.
Right,
you know?
Right. Hey, might as well go out with the lid off, you know?
Exactly.
What, how did your deal with Vanguard come about?
Well, it was pretty cool. While I was still with Columbia, you know, I wasn't getting any calls, and I was afraid I was going to end up like a lot of other singer-songwriters that are on major labels where you put out a record every 5 or 10 years, and that's just not what I want to do. You know, I want to keep making music. Vanguard wrote me a letter, and Steve Buckingham here in Nashville wrote me a letter, and he said, listen, I know you're still with Sony, and I don't want to get involved with that, but if things change for you, we would love to record you. And so I just kind of always kept that in the back of my mind, mm-hmm. and a few months later, I asked to be released, and then I signed on with Vanguard.
So there you go.
Yeah.
Well, you've got a new record out, Honeydew, and there's an interesting story here on the bio about the creative process. You're recording on an old guitar and a computer, and your house is broken into. So that could be devastating for a lot of people. But to talk about that story.
I know. Well, some songs, not really the whole songs were lost, but few poems and short stories and a lot of kind of creative ideas were lost from the computer being stolen. And then my old J50, it was like a 57 Gibson J50 was stolen, and that really hurt me. You know, I mean, I was like losing a family member. And in fact, my mom had passed away just a few months before the house was cleaned out. Mm-hmm. And so that was a real bummer, you know. And I remember just thinking, what more can happen, you know? And then my road dog died. It's like a bad country song, I don't
right.
know. But,
right.
but it, you know, all I need to do now is hop a train, right? But it ended up being fodder for, you know, it was therapy when I wrote these songs and recorded them with my good friends that have been working with me for years. And I just got a great team. You know, they're all really good at what they do. And Peter Stroud, who's an Atlanta guy, but he's Sheryl Crow's guitar player. He was off the road for a little while and he came in and worked with us. And he had on the last record too. So, you know, it was just a real fun, creative time. And also it was heavy at times because of songs coming from mm-hmm. kind of being born from grief, you know.
Coming up, we'll get an exclusive in-studio performance by Shawn Mullins on this special edition of Music Business Radio.
Are you an independent artist, a record label, or maybe you have a project that needs to be put on CD? Let New Life Digital Media show you why their customer service is second to none. At New Life Digital Media, any and all aspects of your next CD project can be handled. Whether you need 100 discs or 100,000 discs, New Life Digital Media will provide you with retail-ready CDs that can be sold at your next show. New Life Digital Media manufactures, prints, and packages your CDs under one roof, right here in Nashville. With over 50 years of market experience, the good folks at New Life Digital Media understand that you, the customer, come first, and your project is just as important to them as it is to you. New Life Digital Media is fast, reliable, and competitively priced. Call 1-888-868-1179. That's 1-888-868-1179. Or check them out at newlifedigitalmedia.com. That's newlifedigitalmedia.com. Make sure you sign up for the monthly drawing to win 1,000 CDs. New Life Digital Media. They make it simple.
Hey, this is Pete Yorn, and you're listening to Music Business Radio.
You're listening to a special edition of Music Business Radio with Shawn Mullins.
Let's talk about your writing and the process of writing and when you're writing these songs. Do you know when something's going to be a hit? Obviously, Leslie Fram, when she heard Lullaby, she said, hey, this is going to be big. Did you have any idea?
No, in fact, I kind of laughed when she said that it was a number one, you know, because I thought she was just pulling my leg. And, you know, I'd been doing it for almost 10 years, and it was my 8th release, and I hadn't had a number one yet, you know.
Right.
But when I wrote it, I remember I wrote it after playing at a Chinese restaurant, and it's also a little music venue out in Hollywood called Genghis Cohen. Great Chinese place, and they have these church pews off to the side, and it's a tiny little room, and songwriters go in there and play, and you don't make any money or anything, but you you know, it's a good place to try out material. And after one of my shows, this young woman about my age, she was in her late 20s, she came up to me and she sat down and we had some Chinese and we started talking. And she had grown up there, and she had her father had been in a rock band that was pretty popular, and she used to hang out with Michael Jackson when he was a kid, and Sonny and Cher's kids, and all this stuff started ringing for me. I was like, wow, this is a real intense story. And she was older than she was, you know. You could see it in her eyes that she had already done all that stuff. You know, anything that you could think of, she'd probably done it, which is probably not uncommon for a lot of Hollywood kids. And this song kind of wrote itself, really. Over the next couple of days, the lyrics really kind of fell into my lap. And I think that that's one of the easiest songs I've ever written. And I don't really think it's my best, but I think it was one of the quickest that were written. And, you know, I never really know. Like, I remember when Beautiful Wreck, Glenn Phillips had started that. And when I finished that up and kind of wrote the chorus to it and everything, I felt like it had some potential, having been on the radio before at that point. I was like, well, maybe this song will do well, but you never really know. And also, I don't know if I'm superstitious, but I didn't want to jinx it. So you don't want to go, oh, this song's going to be huge.
Yeah,
you
right.
Because I felt like that's what happened with The Thorns.
Yeah.
Like, I felt like we should have kind of done better than we did. You know, it still sold a couple hundred thousand records.
So, well, it's a lot of pressure when they think you're going to go six times platinum.
And they were all saying that. Mm-hmm. They were all going, oh, this is going to be 6 million records, and it's going, no. And me and Matthew would look at each other and we're like, yeah, you just cursed us, dude. You know, we're thinking to ourselves, we're never, you know, we'll be lucky if we sell 50,000 records the way you guys are doing this. But I never really put a lot of stock into what I think is going to happen, because you just never know.
Well, just, I guess the song comes first and you let it find its own voice.
That's right. And you get it in the hands of the right people, hopefully. You know, that's part of it, too, is you have to work it. And if you don't have a publishing company to work it for you, or a record company to work it for you, you've got to work it. Of course, now the opportunities are better than ever for that. I mean, it's wide open. You know, the way the internet and digital and all that stuff is, a virtually unknown person can, you know, have a hit song through a commercial or whatever now, which is which
are you
is
are you looking into that stuff? Would you have a problem if somebody were to use like Lullaby for diapers or some kind of baby type thing?
No, I mean,
not that it really matches, but Lullabies, you know.
No, I've had that song's been licensed a lot, usually out of the country, like South Africa. There was a security system that used it, and like a home security system, and a lot of my songs get licensed. I mean, that's, again, you get down to kind of future income that way. You know, you don't want to turn that, in my opinion, as a songwriter, you don't want to turn that kind of opportunity down. And for me, that's not selling out at all. That's just smart.
Well,
you know?
Selling out is getting the corporate job, working at Starbucks, digging ditches.
Well, maybe. I mean, I don't know. It might be that, you know, I mean, I know people that are baristas. I don't know any at Starbucks, but I know some at, you know, local coffee places. And some of them are artists, and they're doing that to make a living while they're following their bliss, too, you know. And that's to be commended to me. That's a lot harder in a way, because you're having to do two things. And my buddy Kenny Thomas, who's a good writer here that's gotten a lot of cuts, he was in the Airborne Rangers, and he was in one of the guys that was in Black Hawk Down, one of the real guys that survived that. Mm-hmm. And I remember for years he was trying to get it going with music, and we would sit and talk and write together. And I said, man, you know, just eventually move to Nashville, give it a shot, see how it goes. And he did. And a couple of years into it, he's got, you know, I'll be watching, you know, CMT or whatever, and I see Thomas down there.
Yeah, right.
I'm like, get on you, Kenny. You know, it worked. And
yeah.
So I think a lot of it is just sticking to your guns and not giving up. You know, giving up's the easy thing to do in this business, because you hear the word no constantly. And I think the way you survive is ignoring that and driving on and trying another avenue, you know.
You mentioned coming to Nashville. You were an Atlanta guy. Mm-hmm. I know when you did the major label thing, you were spending a lot of time in L.A. The typical day in those three cities, is it different?
Oh, they're really different. You know, I've always loved Nashville because Kris Kristofferson got his start as a songwriter here, and a lot of people, you know. I mean, but Chris has kind of been he's always been kind of my hero, and I always knew that Nashville would understand what I did eventually, you know, somehow. So I've always had an affection for Nashville, not so much with LA. You know, I really, first time I went out there and played Genghis and played a couple other places, I thought to myself, wow, you know, I don't know if I should even bother. And honestly, I hate to say this, but I still feel that way. And this last tour, I played the Troubadour and, you know, 130 people. It wasn't like a packed out crowd, but that was the most excited LA crowd I've ever had. And it made me go, okay, I'm going to come back and play this place again. Right. And it gives you hope, you know, but yeah, in general, there's just so much fraud and fake and, you know, glitter and all that stuff that it kind of washes over everything that's real. And there's tons of real stuff there. I mean,
oh, yeah,
you know,
definitely.
Typical day there for me is going up to the hills, visiting someone like Matthew Sweet, who lives out in Laurel Canyon. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of great writers, you know, and most people kind of live outside of Hollywood. They'll live up somewhere where they can create, mm-hmm. you know, somewhere in the woods where they hear coyotes at night. And a typical day in any of these places is usually when I'm on tour, it's kind of fast and furious. You know, we're usually doing interviews and we're doing going looking for barbecue and, you know, going to a record store and doing a signing and then sound check and a show.
Right.
You know, you get 5 or 6 hours of sleep that night and you get up and do it the next morning. And the cool thing about living in Atlanta for me is that it really does take things away. Like there's a huge music industry there, but it's mostly hip hop.
Right, right.
And I know a lot of those guys and it's fun to be a part of that too. But for me, Atlanta's my home and it feels really different. It doesn't feel like an industry to me mm-hmm. the same way Nashville and LA and New York feels. I mean, and Austin even, you know, Austin's gotten more and more, like we were just at South by Southwest and it was so funny. You know, I looked around and I thought, gosh, there's so many musicians here, you know, and obviously there were. But I remember one time I was sitting on this bench and these two guys who looked like rock stars. I mean, you know, I was dressed in tennis shoes and whatever and
yeah.
and a sweatshirt or something. And I probably looked like the custodian or something. And there's these two guys sitting next to me with they're totally from head to toe. Everything's in place and they just totally look like rockers. Well, I started listening to their conversation. Neither one of them were musicians. The one guy was a manager and the other guy was an agent.
Right.
And I thought, wow, isn't that funny? You know, and people are trying so hard just to look the part, you know?
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
And, but yeah, as far as like a typical day, there's not really any typical day. Every day is a little different. And, like I said, I love doing it. And even in LA, you know, where if it hadn't been for LA, Lullaby wouldn't have come about. So I feel real thankful a lot of times for that.
Well, you've got your guitar with you.
Yeah.
You know, let's have you play something and give me the story behind it.
This is an Atlanta story, really, and a lot of the new album kind of takes place in my hometown of Atlanta, and there are a lot of real characters, real people, and as a songwriter, you have to be an observer, and I remember finding that the more popular I got as a recording artist, the less I was really able to observe. The reason was that I was being observed, and that was a really weird feeling, you know, and I remember when I cut my hair off and people didn't recognize me anymore. It was such a relief. You know, I'd walk through the airport and people weren't stopping me for autographs.
Right.
I could people watch again.
And yeah.
It was a really great thing. I was able to start writing. And this album has a lot of personal stuff and also real characters. There's a lady named Katherine Johnston. You may have heard of this story. She was shot and killed in her own home by the Atlanta Red Dog Squad, which is a drug task force. Somebody had told them that her house was the big drug house on the street. And it wasn't, but they came and busted through the door and she thought that she was being, you know, attacked. And so she shot into the air. And I think the bullet lodged in the porch roof and they shot this lady many times, you know, and she lay on the floor bleeding to death, you know, handcuffed while they searched the house for drugs. And they never found any, so they planted some. And it, you know, it more than moved me and she deserved more than a tomb, but it's called Ballad of Katherine Johnston. Old Miss Johnston lived all alone on the sorry side of town. Broke down cars and burglar bars on the windows and doors. In case danger comes around. Sitting in her yellow kitchen, listening to bad news on her AM radio. It used to be Louis Armstrong, then Martin Luther King. Where did everybody go? Out the window old Miss Johnston in the eye of the storm. It was the safest place to hide. Life's a gamble for the broken and the weak, dealing with the bangers and the drugs. The winos weave and amble, shuffle on down the street, steering clear of all the thugs. Everything stayed the same on the night Miss Johnston died.
Up next, we'll have more from Shawn Mullins and another exclusive in-studio performance on Music Business Radio.
Did you ever wonder why there are no songs about banking? I mean, there are a lot of words that rhyme with bank, so that can't be why. Maybe it's because up until now, a lot of people in the music industry haven't found a bank or a banker who really understands their needs. Well, all that has changed. I'm Ron Cox, Vice President of Avenue Bank, and we're dedicated to Nashville and to the music industry that makes Nashville famous. In fact, we created our bank largely for you. We have bankers who have worked for years with people in the music industry. And we all love music. I actually play a little banjo myself. So if you're in the music business and could use the services of a banker who's also in the music business, give us a call at 252-BANK. I'd like to tell you about the Avenue Bank difference. And yes, the difference is real. Avenue Bank, member FDIC. Now let's see. Bank, Frank, Frank, Bank.
Hey everybody, I'm Billy Yates. In Europe, I'm bigger than Elvis. Just kidding. This is Music Business Radio.
This is Michael, president of New Life Digital Media. Are you an independent artist, a record label, or just have a project you need on CD? Then listen closely, and you could win 1,000 free CDs. At New Life Digital Media, we can handle all aspects of your next CD project, from 1,000 to 100,000 retail-ready discs. Think of it. Your music, data, recorded seminar, instruction manual, language classes, and much more, all manufactured, printed, and packaged under one roof here in Nashville, Tennessee. That means your project is done right and finished quickly. With over 50 years of combined experience, our experts at New Life Digital will help you get your CD project from the studio to your fans and from the boardroom to your customers. So give us a call for your next CD project at 888-868-1179. That's 888-868-1179. And check out our video tour at newlifedigitalmedia.com. NewLifeDigitalMedia.com, where you can enter to win 1,000 free CDs. Enter code NEWLIFE for more chances to win. Go now to NewLifeDigitalMedia.com.
Hey everybody, I'm Shawn Mullins. The most important thing I've learned since being in the music business is sticking to your guns and doing what you love to do. And you're listening to Music Business Radio.
What do you credit with your longevity?
I think it gets back to, you know, doing what you love and loving what you do and sticking to that and, you know, not taking no for an answer. Kind of the follow your bliss thing, you know, Joseph Campbell used to talk about. I love reading and listening to him. And, Chris Christopherson told me a lot about that too. You know, he taught me that you have a duty in a way as a songwriter once you kind of commit to it, to make good by each song. You know, I remember Townes Van Zandt would talk about that too, and he's a huge influence on my lyrics, and I'm sure a lot of people love Townes, and he really took it to another level. He's kind of the mark we're all trying to hit, you know. But I think longevity has a lot to do with just not trying to change with times and trying to be hip with whatever's popular now, and don't try to just do that. You do what you do, and eventually it'll come back around again, you know.
You'll convince enough people that it's cool.
Yeah, or maybe not. You know, I mean, I don't feel hip as I travel around the country as a folk singer. You know, I mean, in the midst of all the hip hop and R&B and American Idol stuff, you kind of feel like some old guy that's doing this lost art, you know.
Right.
But I still love it. It doesn't really bother me.
Well, and you're doing 200 dates a year, you said. So obviously somebody loves it.
Yeah, you know, and like I said, I'm lucky to do it, but, you know, I'm not playing stadiums or anything, but the intimate rooms that I play, they're usually packed out with people, and people are singing along, and it's a really good feeling.
Well, let's talk about the pace. I mean, you're saying, yeah, you love it, but that's 200 dates a year, and, you know, you played a show in town yesterday, you came into the radio station this morning, you've got this kind of interview. That's a lot.
I'm used to it, I think. You know, and plus, it gets right down to the fact that it's easier than digging a ditch every day.
Right.
Now, I spent a little time in the Army. We didn't talk about that, but I was active duty for a couple of years, and I was an airborne guy. And so, you know, as an infantryman, you're digging a hole and sitting in it, you know, and waiting for the enemy to come or whatever.
And
so I got a taste of kind of a much harder...
What things could be.
Yeah, or just physically, it's much more demanding, you know. I got used to not being able to sleep. I got used to being able to sleep in a vehicle. So I ended up touring around in my van, and it was kind of a step up from a foxhole, you know.
What's your favorite part of the typical day?
Probably barbecue, trying to find the best barbecue in America.
Right. You hang out in Texas a lot, I guess.
Yeah, and you know, in Georgia and Alabama, too, and the Carolinas and Tennessee. Yeah, I mean, there's great barbecue everywhere, and I love it all. But we were always looking for good restaurants and interesting record stores. And before my shows, I go through kind of a period of anxiety where I sit and I don't know if we can talk about this or not, but recently I got sober, and for about 12 years, I was baked. Pretty much the whole time. And I remember, don't remember actually. What was I talking about? No. You know, it's an interesting thing though. It all kind of cleared up for me. It's a little harder to kind of go through life with clarity and with kind of an understanding of every moment.
Yeah, you're forced to look at some things that might not be easy to look at.
Yeah, but I found it to be kind of a blessing at the same time. And I needed that, you know, and I just turned 40, you know, some of it was just ready to grow up. Mm-hmm. You know, I've always been a late bloomer. And a lot of people, you know, playing in bars and everything, they go to alcohol, but I never really did. And there's a lot of alcoholism in my family. I always was afraid of becoming an alcoholic, but I ended up becoming a stoner instead. That chemistry's still there. Mm-hmm. So that's something that I struggle with. And now I have to kind of deal with a nest of bees in my stomach and in my head before I play, which for many years I just fogged my way through. I'm a much happier person now, and I think I put on a much better show, actually. I think that's one of the reasons why people come, is that I'm giving them every ounce of thing I've got, you know. Every bead of sweat that comes out of me is focused on doing the very best show I can.
Well, I just saw the show that you did in Nashville. It's just unbelievable. And you know what I was thinking? I was just like, man, this guy, 200 dates a year, it's like you're performing for the first time. Or it was to me, you know. I'm sure you do that show a lot.
There's a part of it that feels like that for me too, though. That every time I do a concert, it's a brand new room of people, and they're usually pretty excited because it's been, you know, 6 months since I'd been there, and there's usually more people than last time, and it always feels new to me, actually. You know, very seldom does this get old, the actual performance part. The travel, of course, can be a tough thing, but... Like I said, when I'm home for very long, I start to get antsy, and I think I need the road. I think I've always wanted to be a traveler, and you know, we traveled a lot when I was a kid, just, you know, all over America in the big Buick station wagon, you know, and we were Mormons for a while when I was a kid, and I remember we went and made a trek out to Utah, and I've written some songs about that, you know, and we kind of played musical religions when I was a kid. So every couple of years we were doing something else, you know.
A lot of influences.
Yeah, now I don't know what the heck I believe in. I believe in the music.
Let me ask you this. You said you were married, and of course you're doing 200 dates a row. How do you keep the balance now?
You cheat a lot. No, I'm just kidding. Well, the main thing is, you know, Kelly used to travel with me quite a bit. And then when she opened a little boutique store in Atlanta, it kept her there more. And plus, she really got tired of the travel. It wasn't really as...
It's not for everybody.
It's not for everybody. And so what we do is every 3 or 4 weeks, I come home for a couple of weeks, or at least a week. And also, we talk 2 or 3 times a day. And she comes out to see me in certain places where she can get out. And so, you know, it is hard being married and not having your loved one with you. But she understands it. You know, I was married before. She's my second wife. My first wife really didn't get it at all, and her family didn't get it. And they were country folks. They lived up in Blairsville, Georgia. And they were like, what is this guy thinking he's going to do? It was kind of like my dad, you know. Yeah. It was a real, like, are you really going to try to do this music thing, you know? And her father had offered me a teaching job. He was the superintendent of schools, and I turned it down. He just couldn't believe it. I was like, you know, I just really got to follow this. I've got to do this. It's not just a dream. It felt more than a dream to me.
It's a calling, it sounds like.
You know, I've always wanted to do this. You know, even when I was a toddler, I remember wanting to perform and create. So, but yeah, it is tough on a marriage. And, we don't have kids. And I'm hoping that we will at some point. And I think when we do, I'll probably tour a little less just so that I can be a good dad and be home some, you know.
What's your advice for upcoming songwriters? Got a lot of guys listening now. They think, man, I sure wish I could be like Shawn Mullins.
Oh, man. That's nice you to say. You know, I think the biggest thing I would say would be whatever it is that you do, you got to keep doing that. And also, a good song is a good song is a good song. You know, that people get so wrapped up in categories and styles and what's hip and what's not. The best songs in the world can be done almost in any style.
Mm-hmm.
And so as a songwriter, you have to kind of keep that in mind. I don't really get hung up in fashions of songs and styles. I just kind of write what I write. And when we go into the studio, we kind of put together the instruments that seem like they would be right for it. But it could go another way too, I think. And like Christofferson had said, don't ever do it for the money. If you start doing that, you're going to start writing crap because it's going to get real fluffy and real surface level, kind of catering to the lowest common denominator. I don't mean that really as the listener so much as it is the business end of it. It's kind of like I've heard a lot of songs, not just on country radio, but on a lot of radio styles that you just go, wow, really? That made it on the radio, you know? And that's hard to believe, you know, and because the lines are so kind of fluffy. And
Right.
And I think that's cyclical in music. I think, you know, there was a time before everything really got cool in the 60s when people like Bob Dylan came around. You know, you had How Much Is That Doggy in the Window? And yeah. Which is fine. But
yeah.
And I think we're in a time now with American Idol and a lot of that stuff where, you know, the biggest stars in the world are the American Idol folks. Most of them aren't songwriters. Most of them are singers that are performing, you know.
Well, it's an opportunity for songwriters at least.
Absolutely is. And another thing as a songwriter is you kind of put it out there at every level. You know, you don't try to get stuck and try not to get caught up in one thing. This is what I do, and that's the only thing I can do. I think you have to keep branching out and trying to write better, try to get better every time, you know. And that's always a goal of mine, is to become a better songwriter every song I write.
And how do you do that?
I read a whole lot. I read a lot. I observe. I watch the news. I read the news. And as I travel through America and Europe and Australia and Canada, I can see kind of the changes, you know, as they go by me, you know. And especially when you're not flying, when you're on the road.
Oh, yeah.
You can really get in touch with the essence of America. And you see the towns that used to be mill towns that are dwindling, and the Walmart's moved in, and everyone goes there, and there's no general store anymore. There's no mom and pop, you know, record store in town because there's the big chain. And a lot of that stuff, that's good fodder for writing for me. And I think it's also important to write about.
You mentioned Australia. What a lot of people don't know is that you're pretty big in Australia.
Yeah.
And you had a funny story from the show here. I'd like you to tell that because that's something worth giving our listeners.
Well, it was funny. The first time I ever went to Sydney, my song Lullaby was already a big hit there. And Shimmer was even starting to become a hit. I had no idea. I remember getting off the plane. And the difference in Australians and a lot of Americans is that they make you feel like you're part of their family instead of that you're this intangible two-dimensional character that they've seen on video. They end up coming up to you and, "Hey, Shawn, I saw you last night on TV, mate. It was great. Hey, would you come over for a bobby?" You know, is that, it's really like that down there.
Just it's hanging out with everybody.
They're really sweet. And, you know, it's kind of like America probably was in the 50s, where it's just, it's still in this really friendly place. But I remember standing in the street corner in Sydney and watching the street musician. And I'd just gotten off the plane, you know, and I was all jet lagged. And it was probably 11 or 12 midnight there. And I was watching this guy play and really getting into it. And this paddy wagon full of cops pulls up beside me. And I'm thinking, not already, you know, I'm going to get busted. I just got here. You know, I'm thinking, what have I done? And the driver rolled down the window. He's like, "Hey, it's Shawn Mullins." And I couldn't believe it. These cops totally knew who I was. And they all jumped out. They were like, "Have a picture with us, mate." And so we started taking pictures and signing autographs. And I noticed that there were probably six people in this paddy wagon, and only two of them were in uniform.
Right.
But they were all police officers. And I said, "Well, what's going on?" They were like, "Oh, we're just driving our friends around to all the bars so they don't have to drive, you know?" And they were taking all their off-duty friends from bar to bar all around Sydney. And they were like, "Well, come have a beer with us, mate." And so I said, "Sure." I jumped in the paddy wagon and off the road we went. It was great, man. I just ended up, you know, really feeling it with the Australians. You know, they're great people.
Yeah, yeah. This sounds like even the cops like a song, are cool. Right?
Yeah.
What is the biggest? Well, maybe not the biggest, but the accomplishment in the music business that you're most proud of?
You'd mentioned longevity. I think that's some of it. Is I'm pretty proud of the fact that I haven't gone away, because it's easy to do. I mean, unless you have a string of number ones where you kind of up there and you're making a lot of money and you kind of feel like you have to keep doing it. That wasn't really the case for me. I had one big pop number one hit, and then for a couple of years it was kind of back to what I was doing again, you know. And since then I've had a few other number ones, Americana and AAA type number ones, but which is always what I wanted to do anyway. I mean, my goal was to be on AAA radio and all the cool stations. I never wanted to be a pop star.
Right,
so that
right.
was always odd. And I think I'm proud that I stick to my guns on the kind of thing that I do, and that I'm not trying to write something that I'm hearing on the radio as a trend. And I know I've mentioned that a couple of times, but I really think it's key to becoming a long-term songwriter. You know, you find out what you do and you do it and you start doing it well.
You know, you mentioned like American Idol and pop and fame. Do you think that's where the music business is headed, or is it going to be stuff like you're doing, like the 200 dates a year, more of like a local thing and people being who they are?
Well, I think both will kind of continue, but I also think that the singer-songwriter, as far as the person that's really telling it like it is, I think that's a cyclical thing. That my brother's a good example. He's a military guy's career, and he's told me before, he's like, "You know, I like Celine Dion." That's what he tells me. He goes, "That's what I like." He goes, "Because I don't have to think. I just get to listen to this person doing vocal acrobatics."
And they make it easy.
And it makes it easy. He goes, and I got to thinking, I was like, you know, a lot of people, when it gets tough for them in their adult lives, they got kids, they got all this stuff, they may not want to hear how things aren't cool and how they need to change. I said, but I think that it's cyclical, that it always comes back around, that people start to get tired of that fluff, mm-hmm. and they're going to want something deeper.
And when they do, you'll be ready.
That's right. Well, me and a lot of other people. You know, yeah. There's so many cats out there doing it that are doing it well, and like Jeff Steele and
absolutely
great songwriters all over the place. That, and I meet them all over the world. You know, I meet great musicians all over that are not trying to cater to any particular thing. They just do what they do.
Now, you've got one song here. We were talking about it throughout the show here, and this is really what introduced you to the world.
Yeah.
In a really, really big way. It's called Lullaby. It's been licensed by security companies and everybody else. Let's get your version of it.
Yeah, this song's been really good to me, man. Well, she grew up with the children of the stars, in the Hollywood Hills and the Boulevard. Her parents threw big parties, you know, everyone was there. They hung out with folks like Dennis Hopper and Bob Seger and Sonny and Cher. feel safe now in this bar on Fairfax. And from the stage I can tell that she can't let go and she can't relax. And just before she hangs her head to cry, I sing to her a lullaby. I sing, everything's gonna be alright. Rock-a-bye, rock-a-bye. Everything's gonna be alright. So rock-a-bye, rock-a-bye, rock-a-bye. She still lives with her mom outside the city, down that street about a half a mile. And all her friends tell her that she's so pretty. She'd be a whole lot prettier, you know, if she'd smile once in a while. But you know, even her smile looks just like a frown. Seen her share of devils in this angel town. Everything's gonna be alright. Rock-a-bye, rock-a-bye. Everything's gonna be alright. So rock-a-bye, rock-a-bye, rock-a-bye. So sure about this place. It's hard to play a gig in La La Land and keep a straight face. Seems like everybody's got a plan. It's kind of like Nashville with a tan. When everything's gonna be alright. Rock-a-bye, rock-a-bye. Everything's gonna be alright as long as you try to rock-a-bye. Rock-a-bye. Everything's gonna be alright. So rock-a-bye, rock-a-bye. Everything's gonna be alright. So rock-a-bye, rock-a-bye, rock-a-bye. Say bye-bye, baby. Bye-bye.
Thank you for listening to Music Business Radio. Music Business Radio is a production of Tuned In Broadcasting Incorporated, Nashville, Tennessee. Produced by Gary Crane, David Hooper, and Dan Buckley. Hosted by David Hooper. Engineered by Dan Buckley and Justin Hamill. Production coordination by Paige Presley, and Lester said, don't be late for the meeting. For more information about Music Business Radio, visit musicbusinessradio.com. We are Music Business Radio, broadcasting from the WRLT studios at Marathon Village in Nashville, Tennessee.
Music Business Radio.
Music Business Radio is brought to you by New Life Digital Media, your source for compact disc manufacturing, packaging, and fulfillment. Online at newlifedigitalmedia.com. And by Avenue Bank, Nashville's newest bank that's locally owned, dedicated to serving Nashville's music industry. Find out more at thedifferenceisreal.com.